is that one of the things that nobody ever talks about when they talk about the advantage of P3s is that once you hand over control of this public facility to the private corporation under those terms, you lose flexibility. You lose the ability to change your mind. So let's say you decide you want an offer, you want to offer a regional trauma center that wasn't in the original plan. You got to pay up because that wasn't in the
original. You don't have a simple answer to that question. I just keep doing the math over and over again, and I just keep getting these outrageously different numbers again. I just don't get it. I don't get it. I mean, the industry the industry that lives off putting these deals together is very politically powerful. It's got very well connected people who are well connected to frankly to every political party. I think they just have an enormous amount of clout. So much of what is claimed about P3s is either flat out wrong or wildly exaggerated. When I'm in debates with P3 proponents about these issues, I just come at it from a very simple-minded perspective. I just say, you know, I'm a pretty simple-minded person. So let's just put it really, really simply. Here's what a P3 is. I want to buy a house, I've come to you. You're my mortgage lender. And you said to me, I'll lend you the money to borrow it to buy your house at 6%. And John comes to me and he says, that's okay, I'll lend you the money to buy the house at 8%, and I'll only charge you an extra 10% for doing it. And then I go and buy the house using his money instead of yours. That's exactly what's going on with the P3. The government could go out and borrow the money itself right today at 4.25%. We know they can because they did. And yet they will put together this deal that will have a 10% upfront cost differential for the fees to put it together. And then on top of that, just the financed part, forget about the equity part, just the financed part is going to cost 2 percentage points more, which is going to add in total a minimum of an extra 50% to the cost of the project. It just doesn't make any sense.
Okay, to the mic, please. This gentleman has to ask a question, and then you can go first, and then you come back in. Certainly, sir.
Just to get a better understanding of the mechanics of this, is this a way for the government to keep the debt off of its books? Is this a kind of derivative that we see floating by so that it appears that the government is financing it, but it doesn't show it because this consortium is financing it? I mean, are we in fact having a little bit of a game being played here?
Well,
that was a question I wanted to ask.
I'm tempted to say that you were right the first time. One of the things that P3s do is they allow governments to spread out the costs of capital projects over a long period of time, as opposed to paying upfront all at once and having it show up as an expenditure. That was theoretically one of the advantages of P3s 15 years ago. Because 15 years ago, we had a really stupid way of managing the expensing of capital costs in public projects. Basically, 15 years ago, all the accounting in the public sector in Ontario was done on a cash basis, which meant that you built a $300 million hospital, you showed it as a $300 million expense in that year. Then the accounting rules were changed so that if it was, if the provincial government owned the hospital, it could amortize the cost of the hospital out over the life of the hospital. So that accounting justification for doing P3s sort of evaporated, provided the government owned it. Then about 3 years ago, the government changed the accounting system for the province again and consolidated all the hospitals into the provincial budget. So as we sit here today, that original justification of keeping the lump off the books is no longer valid. Because now, because the hospital's books have been consolidated into the province's books, it makes no difference. Whether it's a provincially owned asset or it's technically owned by a hospital, doesn't matter. It can still be written off over time. And yet they're still doing these P3 deals. But the really bad news for governments is that accountants aren't as dumb as governments sometimes think they are. A friend of mine drew my attention to a footnote in the public accounts of British Columbia that appeared in the public accounts for the first time 2 years ago. In this footnote, it makes the observation that a significant amount of capital, public capital in the province of British Columbia, is financed through public-private partnerships that require the government to make periodic payments over a long period of time. And it makes the observation that those periodic payments, the obligation to make those periodic payments because the government cannot avoid making them, is like debt. And so they produced this little table that calculated the present value of the P3 payments that the BC government was obligated to make so that people could get a sense of what the future obligations of the government were, whether there was formally debt on their books or whether it was the obligation to pay somebody else to borrow the money. Guess what they discovered? They discovered that there's actually more than a dollar and a half of present value P3 obligations for every dollar of officially acknowledged debt. In other words, BC's debt on a comparable basis is actually more than twice as big as they say it is. The reason why I mention this is because I'm sure those kinds of accounting changes are coming here in Ontario as well. I'm sure it's not going to take very long before we're going to open the public accounts in Ontario and we're going to see a calculation of the present value of Ontario's obligations to pay for all these hospitals, and it's going to make your eyes pop.
Can we turn this around?
Okay, I've got to give John an opportunity once in a while to respond to some questions.
You want? I welcome that background because I don't have that.
Okay. At any time that you want to take it.
So I want to answer a slightly different thing. It sort of was in my head from another question, but watch this. The spread, the 2.5%, like in the example that I showed you, on $1 billion is $25 million a year. The nurses, registered nurses of Ontario, are very concerned. Why? Okay. $25 million at $75,000 a nurse, let's say, is 333 nurses. The hospital is booked to have something like 2,200 or 2,300 total staff. 15% of the staff, okay, could be wiped out simply because we've got $25 million extra a year of interest costs. All right? So this interest thing affects everything. All right, so why would we build a Ferrari if we can't put the gas in the tank? It doesn't make any sense. Okay. So I want to answer that.
This gentleman has a question over here.
Great question, really, two parts. The first one is, this PPP scheme is a provincial matter, and it doesn't matter what Oakville does really. That is, we as Ontario citizens and taxpayers can address it in that way, I guess, relative to the town and the 200 million is a slightly different issue.